Welcome back to James Parker Sculpture. Today I'm taking a break from the workshop and I'm going to answer a few of your questions as I explore the incredible Falkland Estate here in Fife. If you've never visited my channel before, my name's James, I'm a sculpture artist based here in Scotland, and this is what you can normally expect to see here on my channel. Today it's wet and wild here in Scotland, and even though it does seem like a day for in front of the fire, I thought it would be nice to get out and blow the cobwebs away, so today you find me here in the village of Falkland. If any of you are fans of the television series Outlander, then seasons 1, 2 and 4 were filmed here in Falkland, and you may recognise some of these sites. This is the incredible Falkland Palace, which was the favoured holiday residence of Mary Queen of Scots. Now, as I try to find somewhere to shelter from the rain and answer your questions, I'm going to take you for a walk to Maspey Den, where there's an incredible waterfall, and walking through the beautiful Scottish Glen feels like walking through something from the Jurassic era. Hope you're not scared of the dark.
Say you think about me because I'm starting to doubt we will find a way back to each other when you're on the other side of the world. I'm here and I'm waiting, but I know I can't say that. We've been at it for good reason, still I'm hoping we'll be meeting soon.
Hope you think it was worth the wait. I have a question here from Mark Williams who says, "Curious Kiwi here, do you have any works incorporating time? I've browsed your website and can't see anything, but then again, I could do with a new pair of specs, so forgive me if I've missed anything." Hi Mark, thanks for your question, and it's great to have you watching all the way from the other side of the world in New Zealand. In short, the answer is no. I've never actually made a sculpture which tries to sort of tell the time, if that's the kind of thing that you're asking about. However, I have thought about it, and particularly with my glass sculptures, as the sun travels round and the reflections within the glass move, I have wondered whether it would be possible to use those reflections in some way to give an indication of time. Of course, the position of the sun in the sky changes from summer to winter, and that needs consideration too. If you remember back to the video I made recently where my friend Capel from Border Sundials told us how to tell the time on armillary spheres, the seasons are represented somewhat with the armillaries that he makes, and I imagine that would be quite difficult to take into account with any sculpture that I might make in glass or stone. But yes, I will no doubt continue to think about that in the future.
I have a question here from Juliet Moot who says, "Hi James, I'm a fine art student at University of Worcester. I'm interested to know how the relationship between materials, site and object influence each other." She also asks, "If working without a commission brief, do you tend to respond to the environment or seek a site for display?"
Hi Juliet, thanks very much for your question. Well, I've never actually studied art myself, so anything that I might tell you is just my own opinion and nothing that I've read in a book. Of course, I do think a lot about the relationship between an object or a form that I'm placing on a site and the site itself, particularly when that's a commission and I'm designing something from scratch. Of course, it's much harder if it's a piece that a client's chosen out of a brochure and basically I just have to deliver that sculpture and install it. Of course, I give them my input into where I think it's going to work best. And of course, I give my clients my input. If they don't have a real preference towards one form, then I will give them my input or try and steer them in what I think is the right direction and in terms of scale and the material that we're going to use to make that sculpture. Of course, art's so subjective that everyone's opinion counts and matters, and it might not necessarily be the same as my opinion. If we leave practical issues aside, such as clients' budgets, which clearly dictate the scale of a sculpture to a certain degree, sometimes things have to be reined in a bit just because we can't afford to work on such a big scale that I might like to work on.
As far as materials go, as you know, I work mainly in slate, and slate is one of those materials which you can take from an environment where you would never normally find slate and then put it in a completely different environment. It might be outside an ancient castle or a really super modern beachfront villa in the Algarve, and it looks equally at home. And I'm trying to create forms that look dignified in the surroundings and communicate with them, and it always seems to work well. So if you're asking me about the object or form, the material and the site, to a certain degree I can leave material to one side as it doesn't ever jar with a site or an object that I'm creating. Glass is slightly different, and of course you have to think about that. But in answer to your question, I think all three are really important, and only at the end of a commission can you stand back and judge whether you've been successful. I don't think I've ever put a sculpture in a place where any of the three things have jarred. Obviously, the site can't be changed. It can be changed within a property, but if somebody's looking for a sculpture for a specific site, then that site takes care of itself, and obviously the material is generally slate. So then you're only thinking about the form, which obviously can be changed in size, or the material can be changed, but generally it's slate and it's just being used in a thicker or thinner form or a different colour. It's a really good question. It doesn't surprise me that you're an art student. I can sort of tell that from the phrasing of the question. But after so long, I know what tends to work. And if it works in the workshop, then guaranteed when it gets to site and it's surrounded by beautiful plants, it can only be more effective. Working a number of ways, my view is that I'm creating sculptures every day for people, whereas a lot of my clients will only ever commission one sculpture in their lifetime. And so I tend to work in a way that's going to work for each individual client. Obviously, I can't change the way I work all the time to suit everyone, but I do my best. Some clients will come to me and say, "That's exactly what I want. This is where I want it," and commission me to make that sculpture or order it from a brochure. And obviously I'm happy to work like that. It's a client's prerogative and I'm happy to create what they want. The other way of working is to take one of the sculptures that I've already made and customize that. They might want it made slightly differently, different size, different material, or mounted differently, that kind of thing. And so I'll do that for them. And the third and final way of working is to work on a completely new commission. And obviously that's what keeps you moving forward as an artist. You'll often do a commission where, because you get really into the design process, actually when you come up with a commission, it might bring with it a few more ideas for other commissions in the future. So it is a very time consuming process, but it is almost always worth it. And yeah, it has led to me doing some fantastic jobs. Those clients keep me doing what I love. And so without them, I wouldn't be an artist. And as I'm about to get onto later, I would never have given up my sort of 9-to-5 job. So thanks very much for your question, and I hope that helps you a little bit.
Now I have a question from Suzanne from Lake Elsinore, California, USA. Suzanne asks, have you ever turned down a commission and why? Can we have a studio tour, and when is the calendar coming?
Hi Suzanne, yes, that's a very good question. In actual fact, I have turned down quite a lot of commissions over the years. It might just be something that doesn't lie within my skill set, and so I don't feel comfortable doing it. It might be something that doesn't appeal to me artistically, in which case I might send a prospective client to someone else I know who I think is a better fit for them and can give them what they want if they're not willing to sort of change their way of thinking and go ahead with one of my sculptures or something that I think will be a good fit for that site in their garden or on their property. I can actually recall one instance where a prospective client came to me to discuss a possible commission, and they were really struggling to articulate themselves, a bit like I am now actually, but they wound up saying, yes, it should look a bit like a swastika. And at that point I decided to make a swift exit. In answer to the second part of your question, I will show you around the workshop at some point. That relies on the workshop being tidy, and as an artist, I do tend to work on quite a few different things at the same time, and I'm sure I will show you around at some point. And finally, I think a calendar is a great idea, and I'm sure we'll look into that in the future. And obviously, if it does come out, it'll probably come out towards the end of the year.
I have a question here from Sandy Blome, who's from Wyoming in the USA. Sandy asks, what project would you like to make next? Perhaps some idea in the back of your mind.
Hi, Sandy. I've actually got so many ideas, I just don't have enough time to do them all. And of course, it's very time-consuming work that involves a lot of materials, so it often involves very big budgets. There are some things I want to do on a small scale. I'd love to study the geometry of plants a lot more. I did one sculpture before I started the channel, actually. This sculpture has sat in the corner of my workshop and has been commented on in quite a few videos. So I'd like to study the geometry of plants a lot more. There's so much that I think I could do along those lines with Fibonacci spirals and things like that. So hopefully I will get a chance to do that in the future as soon as I get some spare time. Also, when you visit somewhere like Logie Almond Estate, where I made a video a few weeks ago, the scenery is absolutely epic. It's a slate quarry, and I have had interest from other people with other slate quarries in other parts of the world, actually in other continents, one in South America, where I would love to do something on a really huge scale. Many years ago, I built a wall in southwest Scotland where I used about 900 tons of stone. There were three of us involved in that job, and if I could put 900 tons of stone into a sculpture, I know that it maybe sounds far-fetched, but I don't think it is that far-fetched, and I think it could look absolutely fantastic. So those are the kinds of things that I would really love to do in the future, and something like that clearly would have to be a commission piece. So hopefully I will be able to do that in the future. Those are the kind of things that I think would be absolutely sort of career defining as an artist. Let's hope that maybe I will be able to do that and take you guys along for the journey if I do.
Now I have a question from Andrew Williston. Andrew asks, what goes into preparing a site for one of your creations? Placement aside, how do you ensure the sometimes quite massive sculptures stay level and true over time?
Hi, Andrew. It's a very good question you ask. And often with some of these really large sculptures, there's as much below the ground as there is above the ground. If you want to create a huge sphere and keep that drama that it's just touching the ground and looking quite precarious, like it could move, you have to make it look like it's just touching the ground. Of course, that wouldn't be safe to do so there is a lot of steel work and often a lot of concrete that goes into the ground. Some of the pieces are dry stone, but others are obviously built with mortar and fixed together. A sphere looks much more effective if it is just touching the ground and striking a glancing blow on a rock or a lawn or whatever it might be. Often the most simple looking pieces look the best, but in order to make them simple, it can be quite complicated. But a sphere does look much better coming to that really fine finish rather than an abrupt punctuated stop. Often it is necessary to use concrete and structural steel as well. Some pieces, of course, don't require that much to keep them stable, but every piece does need to be safe and make them look simple. Often the simple can be quite complicated to actually achieve.
I have a question here from Holly S, who says, was your art, sculpting, always going to be your main love and career path, or did it have to be second to a 9-to-5 job to pay the bills? Your brother Graham does a bit of sculpting himself, only on his cow's hooves. Are there other artful geniuses in the family? It certainly seems to run in the blood. Thank you for your time. Have a wonderful day.
Hi, Holly. I could actually make an entire video about the transition from doing a normal job to becoming a full-time professional artist. I know that I'm very lucky in that I did one sculpture and took my second sculpture to an exhibition and managed to secure about a year's work. There was still a transition period in that I had to make it financially viable. It was all very well securing the work, but being able to charge enough for my work in order to, as you say, pay the bills is a different kettle of fish. And so that did take some time, probably about a year, in order that I could just say, I'm an artistic sculptor and this is what I do for a living. However, from growing up in the farm to becoming a sculptor, I did do lots of things, and I'm quite happy to talk about those different things in another video and offer some advice to people that want to become a professional artist as well. As far as creative genius goes, I'm not sure that any of us are geniuses, but my mother is a very keen writer of poetry. She writes lots of poems in her spare time, and we keep telling her that she should write a book, but she's never done so yet. So hopefully she will do that at some point in the future. She's very busy running a coffee shop in Wigtown in southwest Scotland, and my sisters both help there on occasions, and they are very keen bakers, so very creative as well. My older brother Robert, who prefers to be known as Bob, is a fantastic writer, and he used to be on stage as a stand-up comedian. So I'll put the link to his book in the description of this video. So if you guys want to look it up or even go and purchase it, his name's Robert Parker. So go and look him up and see what you think of that book. Probably the most creative person in my family is my Uncle John. That's my mother's brother, and he is a fantastic musician, a singer, and a wonderful potter. Here are a few of his creations, and if you want to check out more of his work, I'll also put a link in the description of this video to the gallery where he displays his pottery.
LaFon Sweeten says, do you or have you ever created on site as opposed to creating in studio followed by delivery? How frustrating is eye, hearing and breathing protection? Well, LaFon, to answer the second part of your question first, it is made slightly easier by the fact that I got this new mask recently, which you've seen me wearing in so many of the videos. It's a vast improvement from the masks I used to wear. It actually provides a constant stream of pressurised air, so it is much more easy to get used to wearing than it would have been to have worn one of the old masks that I wore for so many years, and it's much safer too. As far as wearing eye protection goes, I do wear it when I feel it's necessary, although I do get picked up quite a lot here on YouTube, and so rather than wear it all of the time, I just wear it when I think it's necessary.
Hi LaFon, well in the beginning most of my work was actually built from scratch on site, but as my work's become more sought after and I send it further afield, it's a bit like the question that people ask when they wonder how my work is fixed together. As I want to send my work further afield, it did become necessary to try and do more of the work in the workshop because I've got a young family. So thanks very much for your question, and I hope that helps you a little bit.
I really hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please do me a huge favour and give it a big thumbs up, and be sure to let me know what you think in the comments. Wherever you are in the world, I hope you're safe and well, and I'll look forward to seeing you again soon.